I don't like horror. You know, a confession. I don't like horror because it's about scaring people. And scaring people is usually a way to control them. You know, it's usually about warning you off or making or trying to... Whenever I travel abroad, you know, I'd say to people, I'm going to Nigeria. They say, Nigeria. You know, you're gonna lock everything, aren't you? I'm like, no. People scare you. They say, you're going to Brazil. They say, oh, I know a man who went to Sao Paulo. As soon as he got off the airplane, they robbed him. They stripped all his clothes. He was found wandering naked. Why are you trying to scare me? What do you get out of trying to scare me? But at its best, what horror does is it talks about those areas of life we don't want to face, those nightmares that we try and avoid. And what sometimes you notice when you're looking at old television programs from like the 1950s, there was this TV show called The Twilight Zone. And it was, even if it was science fiction, it was always a bit scary, always a bit disturbing. And you look at that show now, from 1957, it hasn't dated, because it's about what really worries people. And in television of the 1950s in America, they didn't go anywhere near anything that was going to worry anybody. It was all about, you know, hi, Lucy, did you burn the bread? Ah, I'm so silly, Desi, I'm so sorry. You know, The Twilight Zone was a bit of reality because it was a bit of fantasy. In the situation of Africa, I think horror in Africa has a very special role to play that's really quite different from horror in the West. Because so often there are stories which are about our modern fears, about living a modern life where you're scared. We mentioned a wonderful story yesterday at the panel. It was in Omenana magazine. It's for free, you can go read it, by Tade Thompson, called Monkey House. And it's really an image of modern working, the modern working environment and the terrors that are there, turned into a kind of nightmare. It's a very powerful, very well-written story. And that's kind of what horror does well in the West and in Africa. But there's another kind of horror story where, at first glance, it looks like ordinary horror, but they're dealing with Mamiwati, or they're talking about Abiku. And you suddenly realize that these stories are not just about fear, they're about looking back at a whole body of culture, many, 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 many different cultures. Cultures, you know, Igbo culture, Yoruba culture, Shona culture, these stories that you may have been told by your grandparents, cultures that are in danger of being lost, cultures that perhaps need some attention, or cultures that are just a great source of stories that are important to you. There's many, many different motives for it, but you're looking back at something real that is part of the rich variety of cultures. And that's another aspect. You know, I was talking to a young writer who is just, you know, he's like 20 or something. He's writing these horror stories based on different kinds of realities, and he's drawing, and I just had to say, so the Abiku that you're doing, you know, is that, that's Igbo, is it? And we had a long conversation about the Abiku and the names and the words from Igbo and Yoruba and everything else. Very richly textured. That differs from the West. We do not really have any cultural connection with vampires or werewolves or any of that. And you just have to forgive us a bit, because basically what we do when we write about werewolves or vampires or unicorns or elves is we're actually culturally appropriating from long dead cultures. These cultures mean nothing to us. They are nothing more than an opportunity for whimsy. You know, a little inspiration for a fun story that's a magical story. They mean nothing to us. So you know, it took a little while for us to realize that, oh, there's another culture. There's another story. It's called the Ramakien. That's great, I love that. I'll just write about that. And you know, people are saying, actually, the Ramakien, in Thai culture, it's actually the foundation story for our existing royal family. And we're not really sure how comfortable we are with you turning it into whimsical fairy stories. There's a huge difference, I think, then, from a lot of, I'll call it horror, supernatural stories. Another word for it is traditional belief realism or traditional belief fantasy. And that does a couple of things. It acknowledges that it is belief, it acknowledges it's traditional. It distinguishes it a bit from horror, but also, most especially, from magic realism. I don't personally like the phrase magic realism when applied to African fiction. I think the magic realism is almost the upside down reverse of what's going on in Africa with the multitude of stories. We just had this great news yesterday. I can never say it. Nouvelle Lezanga by Unati Magobeni. I interviewed him in South Africa. He's got two vocations. He's a real writer in his soul. You know, he loves writing, he loves words, and he is actually a working Sangoma out in the Transkei. So when he's writing about Sangoma practice and Sangoma belief, that's his life. It's not actually fantasy, it's something else. So if you can get hold of that wonderful book, I advise you do so. I'm not going to belabor the point of magic realism unless I'm asked to, because magic realism is not horror. But maybe later, if anybody wants me to differentiate, I will. And I have talked enough, and I'm so grateful to be let off the hook by this wonderful woman who's just come in. Chinelo Onwualu.
Hello, everyone. Sorry, I'm late. Confusion with time. Yeah. Hi.
What we're doing is we're just giving everybody 5 minutes to say hi, say their piece on horror, what they want to say, then have mutual discussion, then open it up. Are you happy with that?
Yeah.
Cool.
Hi, guys. My name is Pemi. So I was talking to Shadrick yesterday, and we actually spoke about that, about how it's different how Africans come towards horror fiction as opposed to Westerners, because I think with you guys, as you said, it's not necessarily part of your culture. But for us, we don't necessarily leave these things after the story. I mean, the shortest horror story I know is probably when your mom tells you that if you pick 100 naira on the streets, you're going to turn to yam. The stories we hear aren't necessarily make-believe. Like, there's always, my auntie told me that this happened. I mean, and the kind of horror stories I'm particularly interested in aren't necessarily the supernatural kind. I mean, I'm interested in people eating people. Like, we had Clifford Odjie. My aunt told me about her cousin who started dating this guy, and then they got engaged. They were supposed to go to his village. And then when they got there, she gave Ankara and sweets to the little children. And then one of them called her aside because of this and said, these people are going to eat you. Like, they had dug a hole in the ground and put hot oil in it, and they put mats on it. And then she was supposed to sit there, and then she was going to be eaten. Like, this is real. This isn't fiction. There's a quote by Joyce Carol Oates where she says, the fiction, like, there's no fiction as horrifying as the horror of real life. And there are so many stories that we have here. So many stories. I mean, the supernatural, the realistic, there's so many. And it's interesting how Lola said it would be nice to have more people come into horror fiction. I think a lot of people are writing horror already. I mean, I don't know about the tag on it. Like, if you search African horror fiction writers, you might not find a lot of things. But then if you go to Omenana, there are so many horror stories there, but they are not necessarily tagged horror. So maybe you guys could talk a little about that, about the horror tag on these stories, when a lot of speculative fiction is already horror.
I think it's interesting to think about the definitions of horror, and I think that that speaks to what you're saying. I am a writer of speculative fiction, so I've written science fiction, I've written fantasy, and I've written a little bit of horror. Not as much, though, as the other types, mostly fantasy. However, you're right, we do have a very different definition and understanding of horror. I think it has to do with the fact that every culture has something different that it's afraid of. And for instance, I don't think you see a lot of Africans fearing the robot uprising. When NEPA takes the light at the first turn, power surge will wreck all your electronics, you're not afraid of Terminator coming up and destroying you. So I think that, I think also because horror speaks to the primordial, it speaks to that primitive lizard brain in the back of our heads, that that it's ever present in every society. However, how it's manifested is always a little bit different. I find it interesting when I watch horror that is that comes out of the West, and the way that it understands blackness and Africa. So for me, an interesting text that I always like to look at is Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness, which is about this guy that goes into the deepest, darkest Africa and emerges changed because of all the terrible, awful things he's seen there. Now, this book is based on a real-life person who went down the Congo River, a real-life trip that Conrad took, and some of the experiences that he had. But because of the way he had already understood blackness and Africa and what Africa means, it took on a very, very different meaning. For instance, he talks about cannibalism in that part of the world. Whereas when you look at the cultural anthropology, what he's talking about is something very ceremonial, something that only happened when you killed your enemy. You ceremoniously ate a small part of his heart to take in his powers. And yet, when it's turned into the Western imagination, you have Africans with bones through their noses cooking up, you know, cauldrons of white folk that they're going to eat up. So it tells us a lot about what it is that people are afraid of. And I think it's always interesting when we talk about horror, what I see, the themes that I see emerging, is that we are more afraid of the spiritual. We are more afraid of curses. We're more afraid of the that which lies just beyond the reality of our lives, in a way that is very, very different than what you see in the West. So I'm not sure how much of our imaginations are taken up with things like aliens, you know, because that involves a sort of technological progress that we don't normally identify that closely with. There are subcategories of people thinking about future and technology, but we tend to think of it in a very positive way. When we think of our futures, we think of a future that has light. For instance, you see stories where it's like, oh, it's all solar powered, so we'll never have to worry about NEPA ever again. And that's technology for us. So it doesn't have some of the same fears that are associated.
I think the point you're making about the other is very, very interesting. It's quite amazing how much of Western horror is taken up with fear of the other. And you know, it really is. You mentioned Heart of Darkness, but they were perfectly able to take Heart of Darkness and adapt it to Apocalypse Now, basically using the same story but transferring it to Vietnam / Cambodia without blinking. I mean, it was just the other. You mentioned aliens. Aliens are always a source of terror. Foreigners are a source of terror in throughout all that fantasy. It's very strange.
It's not actually. When you have a history of oppression and sort of going into other people's countries and destroying their cultures and their lands and their languages, the greatest fear you can have is somebody coming back and doing the same to you, right? So when you look at War of the Worlds, H.G. Wells' War of the Worlds, it's basically a colonial narrative where the Martians have come, colonized the Western world, and is about to do exactly to them what they have done to Africans, to Asians, to, you know, the indigenous people. So, yeah.
To be fair to H.G. Wells, who was an amazing fellow, he was doing it so that Western readers would say, this is what it feels like. All they've got is a heat ray and an airplane, and they're devastating you. How do you think it feels the other way around? And So he was a pretty, but yes, I mean, all those alien invasion stories, one after another. They're here to steal our women. You will be amazed how many really bad science fiction movies there are about we're here to steal your women. Or even really sicker, all these slightly flabby 1950 actors and all the alien women can do, they're here to take our virile, handsome men. You take a look at the actors and say, you've got to be kidding.
You know? You can keep them, yeah.
What are the African strands of horror?
What I've noticed in the 2 years that we've been running Omenana, some of the themes I've seen that have struck the most powerful chord. There's a story, we never ended up able to publish it, but it was by a young man, a young Cameroonian writer named Wise, I've forgotten his name, but last name Wise. The story is titled Kabongo. And in it, it has this passage that describes this young man who goes to sleep every night and is tormented by witches. Now, the scene that he draws, that he creates of that torment is some of the most terrifying stuff I've ever read. You know, it describes how he is laid across on a slab and they start eating him alive, you know, and the way he talks about this. And this is something that this character goes through every single night that they fall asleep. And, you know, by the time he's 14 or 15, he has gone mad. You know, he walks around, you know, crazed up and down the streets. And the story is told from the point of view of his mother, who can't understand why her son, who was, you know, was a lovely baby, a lovely child, all of a sudden went mad. Until one day he finally sits her down and tells her, this is what happens every time I close my eyes every night. And I tell you, as I'm talking about it, I have like, you know, goosebumps because the passage he wrote, and I think that it taps into something quite deep in us, in what we are afraid of, in a way that nothing else quite touches. And I like the example of, I don't know how many of you guys heard the story of, I think it was in Ogun State, no, it was in Benin, where there was a spate of kidnappings at one point. Until a new governor or a new leader came in and called some of the most powerful dibias that he could find. And they put a curse on the city of Benin and said, anybody who kidnaps anyone within the environs of this city will be cursed. Their ancestors will be cursed. Their children and their generations will be cursed. If you see the way crime disappeared in Benin, it didn't last, you know, forever, but the way overnight. So it tells you that we are not afraid of police, we're not afraid of prison, but if you put a charm on a door, nobody will enter that place. So I've always said that we should have our leaders swear on the shrine of your ancestors when you come into power, and you'll see the way attitudes will change, you know?
There's a story by a young guy called Eozode, and I can't pronounce his last name. It's just come out. He's just got a new collection coming out in the UK. And there's a wonderful story in that about a young man and a family. And again, you know, the uncles say, your father killed your brother. He keeps glancing his gone mother in a mirror, and he doesn't know whether she's alive or dead or what she's doing in the mirror. The father says it's because she's evil, because she's a witch. He then starts getting messages from the woman in the mirror saying, be careful of your father. The father is saying, be careful of the uncles. And the real horror in the story is that this young man has absolutely no way of determining who in his family is telling the truth. Who's zooming who, where the magic is. He does know there's some magic. And his solution is just to leave his family. And that, I don't know if that resonates with you, but it just seemed to me to be really a story about families. You know, you're supposed to, your family is very supportive, you're in your family, but sometimes your family can be a trap. And sometimes you don't know if you want to trust your family entirely. And that was a pretty terrifying story, not because of the magic elements, but because of the emotional elements, the drama of this impossible choice, validated by the magic. The woman in the mirror means that something is happening that is untoward that he has to find out. It was a very powerful story.
Okay. I was going to ask both of you guys, since you've been in genre fiction for a while, so how are people who are trying to get into writing horror, like how, with genre fiction, there's a fear of falling into the formulaic. So, you know, like, to be scared, you have to do this, you have to do that. Like, you're trying to evoke fear out of people. Like, how do you come to writing horror fiction so that it doesn't come as, you know, as a formula? Like, how do you come to it without...
Well, first off, don't follow a formula. And if you've seen that idea several times before, it doesn't have to be too many. Many other people will have. So I don't want to overemphasize originality, but you know, if you've read a story idea in someone else's fiction, maybe it's time to dig a little bit deeper somewhere else. Also, I think the best horror fiction comes about because of, it's a dream image, a nightmare image of something in your own life. And the scarier it is, it's probably in direct proportion to something very truthful that's happening to you. The truth of the horror is that it comes from something that's actually happening that maybe no one's recognizing, nobody's talking about, either because of social reasons or maybe it's just too darn deep inside us.
I would agree with that. In the couple of attempts I've made at horror, I found that it's been most effective when I tap into that which scares me. And of course, everybody has their own unique fears, on their own unique take on what's going to frighten you. But I think it's most effective when you can tap into the physicality of your fear. One of my favorite horror writers is Stephen King, and he's someone who can take something as mundanely scary as waking up in the middle of the night and seeing a light under your door when you know that there's no power, when there's no NEPA or something like that, and make it the most viscerally terrifying thing. And I think that the way he's able to do that is by tapping into like the way your skin prickles when you're afraid, the way your stomach settles into a feeling of lead, you know, the way you feel like throwing up a little bit when you don't know what's going to happen. And so sometimes it's not about the monster so much as it is about the anticipation of the monster, where you don't know what it looks. And that's why I love horror films that never show you the monster's face. You know, when you don't know what it is that is coming for you, it's even more terrifying than when you've recognized it and can now parse out its weaknesses.
One of the things I think I would learn from Stephen King, one of them is that fear is not disgust. Do avoid the blood, the gore, the unnecessary physical details. What will happen is there will be some people who read that and will enjoy it. Most people will feel slightly besmirched, and they may, in their minds, you may have besmirched yourself. So avoid just being disgusting. It isn't scary. The second thing, to go back to the point you were making, I would, by and large, don't learn too much from movies. Not because movies are necessarily bad, but they're a visual medium. They work differently. If you're writing fiction, I would try and learn from Shirley Jackson, Stephen King, how it works when it's written. There's a very good story. What's the story by Chikodili Amidamadu?
It's Pure Water?
Candy.
Oh, Candy Girl, yes. Candy Girl, that's an excellent example. It's,
and that's not Onomanana, is it?
No. Apex Magazine.
Yeah, if you can get hold of that, that's a very good example of African horror done in a literate, elegant, because this is an art form, folks. You don't get a license to write badly just because you're writing a horror story. It's elegant. It's got
and
a great voice.
Too.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm saying it's funny too, and it's I think that's hard to write horror and to make people laugh at the same time. So that's, I don't know.
I have to, like, I guess I would actually take it back to you, because when you wrote one story for a Menana, and it was about a woman who turns into a bird, and it's quite tragic. And it does have some horror elements to it, especially towards the end. I guess I would ask you, because your story was inspired by real life events, and I guess the question I would ask is, how much of, is there a horror in the daily news that we see? Is there a potential for horror even in the things that you read every day in magazines or on TV or list stories that you hear?
Yes, it goes back to the quote I you know, earlier, like, real life is horror. There's from the odd things, like just when something out of the ordinary comes into your ordinary life, that's even Keturah, my other story, which people read as horror, was also based on something I heard on radio in real life. So yes, there are stories everywhere. Like every day someone's like, oh, did you hear this happened? Did you hear that happened? With Bird Woman, it was a popular newspaper story about some old woman. They said a bird hit an electric wire, and then when it fell, it was an old woman. I don't know whether I believed it or not, but I was thinking about it from her own perspective, not necessarily about the supernatural, but being seen as the other, like she was just a woman who turned into a bird, and then people reacted to that because they did not understand it, and that was the horror there. Like, they didn't understand that it was the other, it was the unknown, and so the reaction to that was what was horrific.
A very good story will always be tense, and an element of tension. You may find that parts of your story partake of elements of horror because they're going to be very gripping, they're going to be very tense, they're going to be very frightening, and that's, I always find that's very rich. That you, so if you're writing a story, you're not, I don't think many African writers do this, I don't think many African writers sit down to write generically, at least not yet. So I don't think it's a problem for you, but don't tell yourself, hi, I'm writing a story, a horror story. You're writing a story. Yeah. You're writing a thriller. You're writing something that has psychological implications that run very deep. Don't limit yourself to a genre.
And I think the thing I've seen with a lot of African writing, whether it's horror or other kinds of speculative, is that because we live in a part of the world that doesn't get a lot of play, not a lot of people have heard our stories. So every time we take on a story and tell it from our perspective, it is immediately new. I think a great example is a ghost story I got. We weren't able to publish it, but it was a ghost story in which it was because the woman was haunting her family because they refused to allow her to be buried in her father's compound because she wasn't married. And it's an Igbo tradition in certain parts of Igbo land. An unmarried woman is not allowed to be buried in certain places. She has to be buried, she has to be buried somewhere else, but she can't be buried in her father's compound because it is, obscurity. And so this ghost decides to basically haunt her own family. So the family is running from pillar to post, trying to figure out who's the cause of our misfortune, only to find out that it was them. So, you don't see that perspective alone is something quite unique already. You don't really see it in horror fiction. And so I would encourage anyone who's writing to just look at your own life, look at your own traditions, look at your own native, background. There's so much to mine from that. There's so many stories to tell from that.
Okay, I think we should open it up to the audience, find out what you want to know. So,
what I have is a comment, not so much a question. So we do get a lot of stories in the Menana that are sort of horror-ish. But what I am looking out for, which I probably want the writers to pay attention to, is the things we know that we fear that nobody talks about in our stories. For example, we all know we've all had the story of somebody who dies and they're taking him home. And for some reason, the cops doesn't want to go home. And you get the car breaking down over and over and over. I've heard of the one where at a point in time, they have to bring the cops out and flog it very, very well. to ensure the journey continues. So those kind of things. Then also, there's also the issue of most people here, I'm sure, fear masquerades. We all think that masquerades are people who are wearing a sack. What if you pull off the sack and there's nothing in there? That's scary. So those are some of the things I think we should be looking out for when we want to write. We don't have to write like what Stephen King is doing, but there are things within our own environment that are so scary. We have villages where they say, don't kill this snake. This snake is our mother. What if we have a story of somebody's mother becoming a snake? I know we've had these stories before. These are things we've had, but we've never actually thought about using them in fiction, so which is something I think
I
we
think
should be
my favorite has always been the, if you see a woman who's too beautiful, put a mirror on the floor, and she won't step on it because she's a spirit. Like, what's it? Has anyone ever actually tried that? Like, can you imagine what it would be like to just have that mirror not be broken when she just moves over it?
So much too. If you wake up in the morning and you see a dog, you take the tears and you rub it in your eyes, you start seeing spirits. Or you bend down and look under your leg, look behind you, you see spirits. So I'm looking for stories. I don't write horror, but I'm looking for stories like that, and I'm not seeing them anyway.
I would say your story in the Afro Sci-Fi collection was I thought it was pretty horrific.
There's a story by Masimba Msodzu, who's a Zimbabwean, and he's combining two traditions. It's called Howard Wants to Come Home, and it's about someone's died in the diaspora, and so they're doing a kind of rite where in that culture they apparently invite the spirit of the departed to come home. And what they don't realize is that Howard died because he was made a vampire, a European-style vampire. And they've invited him into the home. So very suddenly, he's there. But the truly clever thing about the story is it's been turned into a nightmare image of regret and loss of the diaspora. That they just can't, I mean, yeah, I'm tearing up. I mean, it's actually such a moving story because the vampire doesn't want to be a vampire. He wants to be home. It's a really interesting story. So you can get all sorts of interesting effects by drawing on different traditions. And the main effect of the horror story may not necessarily be to make you fearful. It may capture other very deep, hard to reach emotions.
Hi, I'm Kobe Graham. Given the fact that so many of our films, I'm Ghanaian, and so Ghanaian and Nigerian films, there are so many of our films that are based in the supernatural. What I'm wondering is if, and this is a question for all three of you, if you had to take one story that you have read, one African story, and change it into a film, if it gets adapted into something and you had all the money to do it, et cetera, which one story would you pick and why?
I would do Howard Wants to Come Home. I really would. I think it would turn into a film very easily. You'd have the family at home, you'd have the mystery, you'd have the moment when the guy shows up. You know, and then it would have a very rich subtext. And I think actors would love to act that film.
There's a great story written by Tade Thompson called The Monkey House. And you might need to make some tweaks to the script to have it flow for the visual medium, but it has such strong visual images. If you look around the room now, you see the way architecture is kind of, you know, join, corner, you know, there's always gaps in walls, there's always like insulation is half falling down somewhere. Imagine if you looked into one of these gaps and something looked back at you. That's just that visual image. And I think that it would make a very, very interesting movie. You could build something out of that. But there actually is a, the name of it escapes me now, but it's a movie and it's horror. and it's a Nollywood film. And it's one of the most effective horror movies I've seen. And it starts out as an action film where three guys steal an object from an ancient shrine that they believe is abandoned. And then basically the rest of the film is the spirit or the god one by one going after these guys and killing them until it gets the statue back. It's an excellent film. I mean, it's Nollywood, but it's a really excellent film.
I'm probably picking this because it's freshest in my mind, but Leslie Neka Arima's Who Will Greet You at Home? It's in the New Yorker, you should read it. It's amazing, you know, it's about women who have to make dolls out of something, and then they go to their mothers, and there's this call and response thing, and then after a while, your doll becomes a human. Even the visual they used for it, I found it really striking, so I would pick that.
We have one question in the back.
The question I have is this. Do you have to be sufficiently skeptical to be objective about horror? Or when you write, is it an attempt for the writer to understand mysticism as it is, or trying to resolve mysteries for other people? Or is it your own attempt to understand reality as it is?
I'm just going to voice a worry about that. I'm very, very worried that you'll take spiritual knowledge that's important and valuable in its cultural context, and you'll try and make it something fearful. Not you personally, but the writer ends up trying to make it something fearful or mysterious or other. I won't belabor the point, but one of the worst novels I ever had to read was a PhD novel about Sangomas in South Africa, which basically turned them into monsters. You need to be very careful about that. If you're talking about a richly fulfilling spiritual experience that isn't scary, I'm not sure that turns into a horror story necessarily. A valuable story, an interesting story, not necessarily horror.
I would say that there are a wide range of different reasons why one would write horror. Examining mystery is one of them. Understanding a tradition is another. Telling a good story is a perfectly legitimate reason to write horror. I will add and say, if you do choose to examine a mystery, a spiritual mystery, to do so respectfully. I've always had a soft spot myself for stories of arrogant outsiders who come in thinking that they know a thing or understand a thing and then find much more than they bargained for. I love it when, you know, the arrogant white explorer, you know, goes into the forbidden forest that everybody told you not to enter. And then your whole crew and party is decimated. Oh, well, darn. But I do think, though, that I have to agree that there is an element of exploitation that can come into it. And we can exploit ourselves. Like, don't think that just because you're African means that you have permission now to tell every African story that there is. You don't necessarily. You may not even have entirely permission to tell the stories of your own traditions if you don't understand them, if you have not been raised in them. So do be careful with that. But there are as many reasons to write horror as there are grains of sand under the sun. The only thing is whether the product that comes out of it is a good story. Is it respectful? Does it entertain? Does it frighten? Does it make you think? Does it make you feel? And I think that ultimately should be what you should be aiming for when you write horror.
I just would like to mention a book I've just thought of by Nai Parks, who's a Ghanaian. In English, it's called A Tale of the Bluebird. In French, where it's actually had a bigger success, rather like Les Andelles, it's Notre Quelque Part, where the translation won all kinds of awards, and then it won all kinds of awards. It's very interesting because it's got a CSI investigator from Ghana returning back to the scene of something, and it's the something is actually a horrific kind of thing that's happened. I won't spoil it. It's a dynamite fantasy idea. It's just mind-blowing. But it's the story is using it to set up, there's the police and modern Ghana, and they're just not getting this very rural environment. There's the CSI investigator who, just because he is an empathetic person, gets a lot more of it. And then it's the privileged voice is actually an old man in the village. And in those, that triangle, you begin to realize that the CSI investigator can begin to identify who might have been involved, but that's it. And the magic around a sense of smell, all I can tell you is that people who are part of a culture, it smells wonderful. And if you're not, it stinks. And it's a very, very original take on the whole thing. It's a very, very original way of addressing a lot of issues of modernity, which is obviously something that traditional belief, fantasy, realism, or horror can address very effectively. And that would make a good film.
So there's this belief where I'm from that witches fly with banana leaves. Now, there's still in the same place, if somebody is caught and is accused of witchcraft, the person is flogged with banana leaves. So you have this thing where witches use, something they use is used against them. Now, I was trying to do a story about this because I was trying to do just a normal story that explores this. The thing is, I am not, it doesn't make me afraid. I actually believe it as well. It's a reality for me, you know, it's just a normal thing. And I was trying to do a story about it, like, okay, a horror story. And somewhere along the line, it devolved into a blood fest. I am afraid of blood. So two things you've said here today. You said, write what you are afraid of, sort of what causes you fear, but also write, don't try to be horror-y sort of about your story. So it's kind of conflicting for me now because the horror-y stuff is what scares me as a person. But as a writer, I don't want to fall into that trap of, you know, doing what everybody else considers horror.
I'm not sure it's a contradiction because when you're writing what scares you, not necessarily trying to spook other people. Every story I've written that people translated as horror, I didn't start to write it with the intent of creeping people out. I mean, it was a story and the horror was a consequence, or it was something that happened afterwards. So I don't think it's contradictory. They are writing something that you're afraid of doesn't mean you're falling into that trap of using those, you know, those tropes of horror to spook other people. So just write your story, I guess.
I would absolutely agree with that. I think you're actually going in the right direction. You started a story that speaks to you, that you're interested in, and then the thing that you were afraid of kind of made its way in and crept its. I think that it's, you know, it's really about how you craft it now. Like if you decide that this is, you've already written a horror story, you may not have intended to do so. See where it goes. I mean, I think that it is a contradiction on the face of it, but the truth is that's how writing works.
Hi, my name is Billy. I have two questions. First, conflict resolution. I read a lot of fantasy, sci-fi, and horror. I realize that most times what I'm waiting for is for the issue to be resolved. And sometimes it's not resolved at the end of the book. It just leaves me on this weird cliffhanger. And that's not a problem every time. But there are times when I read a book that has a sequel. And I start reading a book that has like a book one, a book two, a book three, and it happens a lot with horror, fantasy, and sci-fi. And I get to book two or book three, and it's like they've lost me. Like at that point, it's not even about what they started talking about in book one and two. So I want to ask, number one, how do you personally, in your individual writing styles, handle conflict resolution? And secondly, if you've ever written a sequel, how do you handle not losing people at like the second or the third book? Thank you.
I'll quickly address. Short stories actually work quite well when you get to that moment of maximum psychological tension and horror and you just drop it. That works very well. People don't read novels for that. Novels are about spectacle and unfolding, and numbers of incidents. So yes, a novel probably should resolve. And that is skill in plotting. So that if you're not getting a good resolution in a longer story, it's often helpful to just go through and list all the events in chronological order and make sure that things happen for a reason. Because cause and effect works in chronological order. You may find that there's a whole element of the plot or the motivation you have not worked through or imagined, and that might solve your problem. But skill in plotting is extremely important, and it's right now we have a literary culture that says, that kind of says, yes, oh dear, yes, a novel must tell a story, like it's a complaint. And a lot of literary fiction, I think, is remarkably badly plotted. It's beautifully written, but the character commits suicide at the end for no reason, strange little Miss A, who's 80 years old in one time frame, turns out to be beautiful Miss C in the earlier time frame, and the narrator's known that all along, but he saves it up at the end just to have an ending. You get that a lot. So work on your plots. The plot is not the same as the storytelling.
I would throw that in. I think your frustration comes out of a trend in modern publishing for the trilogy, for the so what I've noticed in modern publishing is that, especially in genre fiction particularly, you can't have a book that's just a book. It has to be the start of the King Killer series, the Magic and the Crown series, or and I think that is just because modern publishing has discovered that you can make way more money with three books about the same characters than one book about the same characters. So what you often have is what I've seen is a stretching out of plots to the point where even the writer, I'll admit this to you, most writers start out knowing what book one and maybe book two is. They don't know what book three, and they sure as hell don't know what book four and five is going to say. Which is why you get a situation like George R. R. Martin, who started out writing a trilogy that has turned into a pentateuch, and is now looking at becoming a seven-book series with no end in sight. And George will tell you himself, he has lost the thread of his plot. He knew what he wanted to do in the first three books, but by the time they saw that it was making money, it kept stretching out and stretching out and stretching out. So what? So the thing about conflict resolution is that, for me personally, I'm trying to write a novel right now, and I'm having a problem with making sure that all my threads connect towards the end. And like Geoff says, it's skill, it's craft, but it also has to do with the needs of the publishing industry, which don't always 100% align with what readers want and what will give readers the most pleasure. I think a great example of this is the Harry Potter series and the fact that they are now trying to make Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them a 5-movie deal. Why? Money. Simple as that. So, yeah.
The granddaddy of all of this is Tolkien, and it is really necessary, is necessary to remember that it was one novel plotted all the way through. And then the publishers said, listen, A, it's too long, so we'll split it up to three. B, we'll get three sets of reviews, and it worked. And that became a commercial template. And really, if you want to write a trilogy, write it as one book all the way through.
Final word.
Send stories to her.
To start with. But I want to just encourage everybody who's looking at writing things that are outside the norm. If you start out writing a story that's ostensibly a romance between a boy and a girl, and then it turns out that the boy is dead, write that story. Don't be discouraged by the fact that it has veered off, the beaten path. There needs to be more stories like that in the world. We have more than enough people writing, and the thing is, it's not that these stories are trivial. They're not, they have something to say. stories that have ostensibly about, that speak about, you know, ghosts, have something to say about death and maybe life itself. A story that talks about aliens is really actually a story about colonialism, oppression, the other. A story about a woman who transforms into a bird is really about discrimination, poverty, and the mental poverty that, you know, you see in urban spaces. So all these stories actually do have something deeper to tell, something deeper to say about the society that we live in today.
One of the gifts of African fiction that I've noticed a lot looking at what people are doing is that by and large people don't limit themselves to genre, and I would encourage you all to try and hold on to that facet. Exactly what you're saying, write the story you want to write and don't worry about genre. We're very lucky in the African context, this thing called speculative fiction is so broad. It can be science fiction, it can be philosophical, it can be humorous, it can have just a touch of magic on the sides, it can be something like magic realism, it can treat Sangomas as absolute reality. Just write your story, and don't worry about this genre thing. It's really not so applicable here, thank God.
And I would say that you shouldn't limit horror fiction to ghosts and, you know, all of these spooky things. Like, I'm interested in reading more psychology thrillers from us. And, you know, just go all out. So thank you guys for coming out, and goodbye.
Thank you.